This is part 14 of Blazor tutorial. In this video, we'll discuss creating a REST API using ASP.NET Core. We want this REST API to return a list of resources, that is, a list of employees. In ASP.NET Core, to create a REST API, we create a controller class that derives from the built-in controller base class. I want to clear a potential point of confusion here. If you're creating a REST API, make your controller class derive from controller base and not controller class. Controller derives from controller base and adds support for MVC views. So create a controller that derives from controller class if you're building an MVC web application. On the other hand, if you're building a web API, create a controller class that derives from controller base. So in short, controller is for MVC web applications and controller base is for MVC web APIs. If you're planning to use the controller both for a web application and for a web API, then derive it from the controller class. If it is just for a web API, then derive it from the controller base. This is the same project we've been working with so far in this video series. Within our API project, we have controllers folder, and to this folder, we want to add a new class file. Let's call this employees controller. Remember, we are creating an API controller here, so let's make this controller class derive from the built-in controller base class. The namespace this class is in is microsoft.aspnetcore.mvc. So let's bring that in. And since we are creating an API controller here, let's also decorate this class with API controller attribute. To specify the route at which this controller is available, we use the route attribute. We want all of our API controllers to be available at this path, API slash the name of the controller. To specify the name of the controller within square brackets, we use this word controller. With this in place, if the name of the controller is employees controller, then this controller is available at the path API slash employees. And if the name of the controller is departments, then it's available at the path API slash departments. Now, we want this employees controller to retrieve employee data from SQL Server database. If you remember, in our previous videos in this series, we implemented this employee repository, which does exactly that, retrieve employee data from SQL Server database using this AppDB context. So we want to inject this iEmployee repository into our employees controller. We need a constructor for that, so let's include the constructor first. And then inject iEmployee repository using the standard constructor injection. Let's bring in the required namespace, which is employeeManagement.api.models. Let's call this parameter employee repository. And let's also generate the required private field by pressing control period and then selecting the second option. Next, let's include a method that's going to return the list of employees. First, let's get the solution explorer out of the way so we get a bit more room. This method is going to be a public method. We want this to be an async, and it's going to return task of action result. And let's call this method getEmployees. Now, when a get request is issued to this route slash API slash employees, we want this method to handle that request. And to specify that, we decorate this method with the attribute HTTP get. If we want a method to handle HTTP post request, then we decorate it with HTTP post attribute. We'll discuss these common HTTP attributes and their use cases in our upcoming videos in this series. For now, let's make this getEmployees method return the list of employees by using this injected employee repository. Notice on the employee repository instance, we have getEmployees method that returns the list of employees. This is an async method, so let's await its execution. I'm going to wrap the result that we get, that is the list of employees, using the built-in OK method. If you're wondering where is this OK method coming from, well, it's coming from this controller base class from which our employees controller is deriving from. What we are building here is an API. It's common for an API to return an HTTP status code. These HTTP status codes tell the client, that is the caller of our API, the status of the request. For example, when this getEmployees method completes execution successfully, it returns the list of employees along with the status code 200 OK. Some of the common HTTP status codes are listed here, 200 OK, if the request has completed successfully. When we create a new resource, for example, when we create a new employee, we use the status code 201 created. If a resource cannot be found, for example, if we cannot find an employee with the provided ID, we use the status code 404 not found. Similarly, if there is an internal server error processing the request, we use the status code 500. You can find the complete list of HTTP status codes and their use on this Wikipedia article. If this method completes execution successfully, then we want to return the list of employees along with the status code 200 OK. But what if something has gone wrong? What if there is an exception processing this request? Well, let's wrap the call to our employee repository using a try-catch block. Simply type the word try and press the tab twice. The stub will be auto-generated for us. Now let's move this call to our employee repository inside the try block. If there is an exception executing this line, we want to catch that exception, log it to a database table or a file so we can review it and fix later. And then we want to let the client, that is the caller of our API, know what went wrong. We may want to return the status code 500 internal server error. In ASP.NET Core, we have several helper methods that help us return these HTTP status codes. For example, OK method returns 200. Similarly, created method returns 201. Not found returns 404. And to return 500, we use this status code method. In the catch block, let's use status code method. Using this status codes enum, first let's bring in the required namespace. Notice on this status codes enum, when I press dot, we can see all the HTTP status codes. We want to return the status code 500 internal server error. We can also include an error message if we want to using this second parameter. Let's include the error message as error retrieving data from the database. With all these changes in place, let's run our solution by pressing Ctrl F5. There we go. We have both our Blazor web project and our API project launched. And notice, by default, our API project is going to this endpoint slash weather forecast. And that's because if we take a look at our API project properties within Visual Studio, notice on the debug tab, we are launching the browser, and by default, it's going to this endpoint, weather forecast. We want this to instead go to API slash employees endpoint. With this change, let's run our project one more time. Notice now our API project is hitting the endpoint slash API slash employees, and we see the list of four employees in JSON format. Let's quickly test our API using Postman as well. Now, to collapse this sidebar on the left, click on this icon right here. And let's copy the URL from the browser, paste it within Postman. We want to issue a GET request, so select GET from this drop-down list, and let's click Send. There we go. We have the list of four employees in JSON format, and we see the status code 200. Okay, that's it in this video. Thank you for listening. One thing.